In 1982, American spy satellites captured photographs of something extraordinary being pulled from the Black Sea. A small, wingless spacecraft covered in ceramic tiles, unlike anything the Soviets had flown before. Western intelligence analysts stared at these images with growing alarm, convinced they were witnessing the USSR's mastery of reusable spaceplane technology. What they didn't know was that this little vehicle, called BOR-4, would contribute to a fundamental misinterpretation of Soviet capabilities, influencing design decisions that would ripple through the space shuttle program for decades to come. Picture this. It's 1966, and Soviet engineers are sketching something that looks like it belongs in a science fiction film. A small, sleek spaceplane that launches from the back of a hypersonic aircraft, screams into orbit, completes its mission, and lands on a runway like a fighter jet. They called it Spiral, and it represented one possible future of Soviet space power. The man behind this audacious vision was Gleb Evgenievich Lozino Lozinski, chief designer at the legendary Mikoyan Gurevich Design Bureau, the same organization that gave the world the MiG fighter jets. But Lozino Lozinski wasn't thinking about dogfights. He was obsessed with something far more ambitious, a reusable orbital spaceplane that could revolutionize how the Soviet Union accessed space. The Americans had their X-20 dinosaur program, and the Soviets weren't about to be left behind in what both sides saw as the ultimate high ground, the ability to rapidly deploy, maneuver, and return from orbit. The full-scale spiral orbiter would measure just 8 meters long with a 7.4-meter wingspan, about the length of a city bus, but far sleeker. At 10,000 kilograms orbital mass, it was a fraction of what American concepts weighed. This wasn't designed as a cargo hauler. This was something else entirely, a vehicle conceived in an era when both superpowers were exploring military applications in space, when the boundary between exploration and defense seemed increasingly blurred. But designing a vehicle that could survive the violence of re-entry was pushing Soviet material science to its absolute limits. Imagine trying to build a shield that protects against temperatures hot enough to vaporize steel, temperatures that would turn aluminum into a puddle in seconds. That's what Lozino Lozinski's engineers faced. They had to develop advanced ceramic heat shield tiles from scratch, materials that could withstand temperatures exceeding 1,500 degrees Celsius and be reused, not just ablate away like traditional heat shields. Each tile was a minor miracle of materials engineering, a carefully crafted ceramic matrix that could absorb and dissipate heat faster than the inferno of re-entry could destroy it. They worked with TEAS AGI, the Central Aerohydrodynamic Institute, conducting hundreds of hours of wind tunnel testing. Picture a scale model suspended in a tunnel where air screams past at hypersonic velocities, sensors measuring every pressure point, every thermal stress, every aerodynamic force. They were perfecting the lifting body aerodynamics that would allow controlled gliding descent from orbit, a shape that generates lift not through wings, but through its very form. Every calculation, every test article, every failed prototype was bringing them closer to something that had never been done before, a truly reusable spacecraft. Then reality intervened. By the early 1970s, the political winds in Moscow were shifting. The Americans had pivoted from their military spaceplane concepts to something bigger, the Space Shuttle, a massive vehicle that promised to revolutionize space access through reusability and payload capacity. Soviet leadership looked at their own programs and made a calculation. The full-scale Spiral, as conceived, was too small, too specialized, too expensive for the new strategic environment. The decision came down not because the technology had failed, in fact, the engineering was sound, but because of bureaucratic infighting and changing priorities. The dream of the Soviet space fighter died in committee rooms, not on the drawing board. But here's where Lozino Lozinski's determination transforms the story. Even though the full spiral was dead, he wasn't ready to give up. If he couldn't fly cosmonauts, he could at least prove the technology worked. His team would fly smaller versions, subscale test vehicles called BOR, short for Bespilotnaya Orbitalnaya Raketoplan. These weren't just models. They were sophisticated, uncrewed spacecraft that would validate everything. The heat shields, the aerodynamics, the recovery systems. If the tests succeeded, perhaps the dream could be resurrected. If they failed, at least they would know. And when those little test vehicles started splashing down in the ocean, American spy satellites would be watching every moment. On a cold morning in 1982, a small spacecraft screamed back into Earth's atmosphere at 25 times the speed of sound. To put that in perspective, a bullet from a high-powered rifle travels at roughly Mach 3. This vehicle was moving more than 8 times faster than that, so fast that air molecules couldn't get out of the way, compressing and heating until they tore electrons from atoms, creating a sheath of glowing plasma that surrounded the craft like a star falling to Earth. Its ceramic heat shield glowed white hot as temperatures climbed past 1,500 degrees Celsius, hot enough to melt copper, to turn sand into glass. Minutes later, it deployed parachutes and splashed into the Black Sea, where Soviet naval vessels were already waiting. And high above, an American spy satellite clicked its camera. This was Cosmos 1374, the first of four BOR-4 vehicles that would fly between 1982 and 1984. Each launch followed the same pattern. A Cosmos rocket would carry the tiny spacecraft into orbit, where it would reach Mach 25 during re-entry. True orbital velocity, the same hellish conditions the space shuttle would face. These weren't gentle test flights. These were full-throttle demonstrations of everything Lozino Lozinski's team had been working toward. And the BOR-4 was remarkably small. Just 3.4 meters long, with a 2.0-meter wingspan, about the size of a compact car. It weighed only 1,100 kilograms, roughly half the scale of the planned spiral orbiter. You could fit one in a large garage with room to spare. But packed inside that compact frame were sensors measuring temperatures that would vaporize most metals and aerodynamic pressures that would tear apart lesser machines. This was a flying laboratory designed to answer critical questions. Could Soviet-designed ceramic tiles and ablative coatings survive the inferno of orbital reentry? Could the lifting body shape provide stable, controlled descent? Could they recover the vehicle intact and analyze what worked and what failed? The answer, it turned out, was yes. All four vehicles, Cosmos 1, 374, 1445, 1517, and 1614, splashed down successfully in the Black Sea and were recovered by Soviet naval vessels. The recovery crews became unsung heroes of the program, racing against both the clock and the knowledge that Western spy planes were circling overhead, cameras recording every moment. Picture these men in rough seas, waves crashing over the deck, working to secure a spacecraft still radiating heat from its journey through the atmosphere. They risked their lives pulling these capsules from the water, knowing that each successful recovery meant validation of years of materials research. Knowing that somewhere above them, American eyes were watching, recording, analyzing. When engineers inspected the heat shields after flight, they found exactly what they'd hoped for: controlled ablation, intact tiles, proof that their indigenous ceramic engineering had worked. The tiles showed the characteristic patterns of hypersonic heating, darker in some areas, lighter in others, creating a thermal map of the vehicle's descent. This was data you couldn't get any other way. You had to fly through the fire to know if you could survive it. Western analysts, watching through their telephoto lenses and satellite imagery, initially suspected something else entirely. The heat shield technology looked too sophisticated, too similar to American concepts. Early intelligence assessments whispered about espionage, about stolen space shuttle secrets making their way to Soviet design bureaus. But evidence later confirmed what Soviet engineers had known all along. This was genuine breakthrough work, homegrown innovation in high-temperature ceramics that matched or exceeded anything the Americans had developed. The Soviets had reached the same solutions through parallel evolution, two engineering cultures converging on similar answers to the same brutal physics. But here's where the story takes its fateful turn. American reconnaissance satellites captured detailed photographs of at least one BOR-4 recovery operation in 1982. Those images showed a small, sleek lifting body with advanced thermal protection, capable of surviving orbital reentry. Intelligence analysts, lacking any context about the program's true purpose as a subscale testbed for a canceled program, made a critical error in judgment. They looked at this sophisticated test article and extrapolated. If the Soviets could build this at half scale, if they could perfect these systems in a vehicle this small, what could they do with a full-size space plane? What kind of operational capability were they developing? And most terrifying of all, what kind of cross-range landing capability did this represent? Those photographs landed on desks at the Pentagon and NASA with the force of a bomb. American engineers and intelligence analysts stared at the images of this small, sophisticated vehicle and asked themselves a terrifying question. If the Soviets can do this with a test article, what can they do with a full-size space plane? The answer they came up with would influence the space shuttle's evolution in ways that would echo for decades. Here's what American intelligence misunderstood. They saw a small spacecraft with a lifting body design and significantly overestimated its cross-range capability. They imagined Soviet space planes dropping from orbit to snatch satellites or strike targets thousands of miles off their flight path. It was a capability that existed more in Western fears than Soviet reality. U.S. intelligence reports from the mid-1980s concluded that BOR-4 demonstrated Soviet mastery of high cross-range landing capability, the ability to land thousands of kilometers away from the orbital track. This wasn't just academic concern. American planners believed this represented a critical military requirement they had catastrophically underestimated. If the Soviets could build a space plane that maneuvered like this, they reasoned, so must we. The perceived BOR-4 capabilities became one contributing factor among budget pressures, military requirements, and competing design philosophies that influenced NASA engineers to incorporate larger delta wings and more complex control surfaces into the space shuttle. The orbiter's weight grew. Each additional kilogram of structure demanded more thermal protection tiles, those fragile ceramic squares that would become the shuttle's defining characteristic and ultimately one of its greatest vulnerabilities. The thermal protection system grew to cover more surface area, creating not one potential failure point, but thousands. Here's the bitter irony that Soviet engineers would later acknowledge. BOR-4 was never intended to demonstrate operational cross-range capability. It was simply a subscale test of heat shield materials and basic aerodynamics. The four vehicles that flew between 1982 and 1984, reaching speeds of Mach 25, and enduring temperatures exceeding 1500 degrees Celsius, were collecting data on ceramic tile performance and lifting body stability. They also evaluated re-entry trajectory control and post-re-entry structural integrity. The lifting body design wasn't primarily about cross-range maneuvering. It was about controlled descent and thermal management, about proving that the shape could generate enough lift to glide to a runway landing rather than splashing down like a capsule. But in the paranoid logic of Cold War intelligence, the Soviets wouldn't build something unless they needed it operationally. So NASA incorporated capabilities to address a threat whose scope had been dramatically overestimated. The consequences were measured in lives. The more complex shuttle design contributed to the vehicle's vulnerabilities during flight operations. That expanded thermal protection system created 30,000 individual tiles, 30,000 potential failure points, each one uniquely shaped, each one critical. On February 1st, 2003, the vulnerability became catastrophic. A briefcase-sized piece of foam struck Columbia's wing during launch, punching a hole in the heat shield. During re-entry, superheated plasma, the same glowing fire that the BOR-4 had flown through, poured through that hole. The wing structure, never designed to withstand such temperatures, melted from the inside out. All seven astronauts died. It's tempting to draw a direct line from BOR-4's misinterpretation to Columbia's destruction, but the reality is more nuanced. The shuttle's design flaws emerged from multiple factors: budget constraints, military requirements, technological optimism, and yes, Cold War threat assessments influenced by vehicles like BOR-4. Would a different design philosophy, one less influenced by overestimated Soviet capabilities, have prevented Columbia? It's possible. We're left with a haunting question mark, a parallel universe we can never visit, where different choices led to different outcomes. Meanwhile, the spiral program's genuine innovations quietly transformed aerospace engineering. Its ceramic heat shield technology, validated through those four BOR-4 flights, directly informed the Soviet Buran shuttle. The lifting body aerodynamics continue to influence modern reusable launch vehicles and hypersonic research. European Space Agency's IXV experimental vehicle and contemporary Russian hypersonic projects still cite spiral solutions as foundational. The technical data from BOR-4's four flights, temperatures, pressures, material performance, made real contributions to advancing aerospace engineering. But the program's influence extended beyond its technical achievements. What it appeared to be, filtered through the lens of Cold War paranoia, shaped decisions that would reverberate through decades of space exploration. The spiral program never flew a single cosmonaut into space. Its full-scale spaceplane was never built. Yet its ghost, a series of small test vehicles misunderstood and magnified by Cold War fear, reached across the Iron Curtain and influenced the most ambitious spacecraft America ever built. In the end, the Soviets showed the West a shadow, and the Americans chased it into design decisions that contributed to a tragedy that would claim 7 lives. The cosmos doesn't care about our fears, our politics, or our Cold War games. It demands only truth, precision, and respect. When we let paranoia influence our engineering, when we design vehicles to counter threats that exist more in imagination than reality, we don't just build flawed machines. We build monuments to our own worst instincts. And sometimes those monuments become tombs. If you enjoyed this story, hit subscribe for more stories where history, technology, and human ambition collide. Thanks for watching.